اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. I want to spend the 3 days I have with you speaking about life's priorities. And I want us to reflect a little bit on the priorities that we've set for ourselves in our lives. And I think this is a important way to make some significant changes in our lives if we do it carefully and reflectively. So we're constantly trying to improve ourselves. Sometimes we try to tweak things one thing at a time. We'll learn something, we'll hear something, we'll read something, and we'll make a change, which is great. That should constantly be happening. The Prophet says, "Man istara yawmahu fahuwa maghbun." So if you look at today and look at tomorrow, and you find that in terms of your closeness to Allah, your knowledge, your character, and these kinds of things, you're basically the same from day to day, then you've really lost. There's nothing like just maintaining. Of course, we can be a little bit understanding of ourselves, but this is the Prophet's evaluation of us. If we just maintain what we have today through till tomorrow, that's good, but in a way we've lost, because the capital that we have, the time we have, which is limited, if we're not doing something with it and profiting, then we've really lost out on the potential that's there in that capital. So it's good to learn, and it's good to progress, even if it's bit by bit, that's good. But a way to make systemic change is to rethink the very driving forces that make our decisions in our lives, the things that we prioritize, make most important, and because of that, then we change our life and we focus it in a new way, right? That's going to have a very far-reaching and deep changing effect in our lives. Today, I want to talk about something that might strike you as unusual, but I want to talk about the idea of dying well. Dying in a way that's correct and proper and healthy. And the reason that I want to talk about this and why the way it fits with priorities, I've experienced a couple of deaths in the last couple of years pretty closely. And one of the things that I observed during the process of these people's death was that the way that they died was not the way they should have died. Let me paint a couple of scenarios for you. Probably they'll be familiar scenarios, either from your own life, if you've experienced death close to home, or through media, through movies, and those kinds of things. We're constantly witnessing death and the healthcare system and these kinds of things, so it shouldn't be too unusual. So one scenario is... So one scenario is of somebody falling sick, becoming critically injured. The first thing that the people around that person will do is call emergency services. As soon as emergency services comes on the scene, they really take over the situation. Especially if you think of a person who's on the verge of dying. Let's think of that since we're talking about death. So they'll come in, move other people away, and really kind of take over the situation from that point on. And then that person is separated from, even if they're with family and friends at the time of the accident, now they're separated. You don't have access to them, you can't talk to them, you can't spend your last moments with them, they're gone. And they die on the way to the hospital, or they die after receiving all sorts of tests and a whole gambit of procedures, right? It's all fruitless, and the person ends up dying anyway. That's one scenario. A second scenario is that the person's already in the hospital on their deathbed. They're elderly, dying of a chronic or some sort of critical disease. And they're basically on the verge of death. And they might have family around. But again, they code. And immediately, the whole system comes into play. Nurses, medical professionals come in. move the family away, get them out of the room, and then take over the scene and do everything they can to try to resuscitate, revive that person, get them stabilized again, but again, they die. So what's wrong with these two scenarios? I don't think they're unusual. That's what I saw, and it seems like this is pretty normal. But there's something seriously wrong with both of these scenarios and with the way that we die and we allow ourselves to die. If we let death happen like this and we handle it in this way, there are, on multiple fronts, there are things that are wrong with that. For the person who is dying, for the family and the people who want to be with that person in those last moments. Let's start with the person himself. We have, in a way, prioritized living at all cost over dying well. And that's where I want to, that's where the theme comes in, that we prioritize dying well over living at all cost. Right? So if we rethink the way death works, we intellectually speaking, we understand that death is necessary, so it's a part of life. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ Every living thing is going to taste death. That's inevitable. So intellectually, we know that. It's easy to say it as well. It's not so easy to when you're facing it, either your own death or the death of somebody else, it's not so easy to come to terms with that. But it's a reality. But again, the way we treat the situation doesn't reflect that. It doesn't reflect that we have come to terms with death, that we accept this as a necessary part of life. Rather, we are so averse to death, and we view death not as the necessary part of life, but rather the end of life. The end of all enjoyment, all just anything that's meaningful finishes with death. That's the practical way that we treat it. Even though intellectually we know that that's not the case, that death is simply the end of this physical life, and it's really a middle point, or even like a, you know, just one step away from the beginning of our real life, right? If you think of it like that, it's just one step away. You're born, and then you die. That's just the very beginning of our journey through eternity. We still have an eternity to go, and we've just basically taken that first stop. Priorities should be with understanding that death is a reality and that we're going to definitely face it. If you look at a couple of hadith, this is one from Imam Ali Laysan that you're probably familiar with. In Najib Balagha, the scenario, the background of it is not so important for what we want to talk about, but this is after the Prophet has passed away, Saqifa has taken place, and now Imam Ali Laysan is challenged by people who are criticizing him basically no matter what he does. If he speaks up for himself and says, wait, this is my right to the Khilafah, then he's going to be blamed. If he sits back and says, no, let's let it go and let them do what they're going to do, then he's also blamed. So he says all of this and he says, in askut yaqulu jazi'a min al-maut. And he says, in aqul yaqulu harasa ala al-mulk. So if I speak up, then they'll say that he's greedy for mulk. He wants to rule. If he's silent, he says, then the problem is that they'll say that he's a coward and he's afraid of death. Right? So he's between this rock and a hard place. He speaks up for himself and says, hayhata ba'da latayya wallati wallahi labnu abi talib anasu bil maut min at-tifli bi thadi ummin. He says, under no circumstances do I have any fear of death at all. Rather, he says, by God, the son of Abu Talib is more familiar and more intimate with death than a suckling child with the bosom of his mother. Right? So he's completely resigned to death. That's not a concern for him at all. He has no fear. That's never even a consideration when he makes his steps and makes his priorities and takes action in his life. All he's worried about is, what am I supposed to do and what's going to make Allah most happy? Not what's the consequence, is that going to cost me my life or not? That's irrelevant. You've got to die anyway. Right? If you've got to die anyway, then why not die in the best way? There's a poem that's attributed to Imam Hussein alayhi salam on his journey. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. On his journey, when he's going from Medina to Kufa, there's a famous encounter that he has with the poet Farazdaq. And in the course of that conversation, the Maqata tell us that the Imam recited the following lines of poetry. Probably it's his, and maybe he's reciting someone else's, but they're wise nonetheless. In Arabic, he says, وَإِن تَكُنِ الدُّنْيَا تُعَدُّ نَفِيسَةً فَدَارُ ثَوَابِ اللَّهِ أَعْلَى وَأَنْبَلُ وَإِن تَكُنِ الْأَبْدَانُ لِلْمَوْتِ أُنْشِئَتْ فَقَتْلُ امْرِئٍ فِي اللَّهِ بِالسَّيْفِ أَفْضَلُ وَإِن تَكُنِ الْأَرْزَاقُ قِسْمًا مُقَدَّرًا فَقِلَّةُ حِرْسِ الْمَرْءِ فِي الْكَسْبِ أَجْمَلُ وَإِن تَكُنِ الْأَمْوَالُ لِلتَّرْكِ جَمْعُهَا فَمَا بَالُ مَتْرُوكٍ بِهِ الْمَرْءُ يَبْخَلُ. He says, if this world is considered precious, then the abode of Allah's reward is greater and more precious. So if you consider the dunya to be something of value, relative to the value of the akhirah, it's nothing. So if you're going after maximum value, maximum pleasure, maximum everything, don't shortchange yourself by sufficing with the dunya. The akhirah has so much more in store for you. Even if you just want pleasure, that's the pleasure that you want, not this. If bodies have been nurtured for death, if the purpose of this physical body that we have is death, then a man's death by the sword for Allah is better. That's the line I wanted to focus on. If death is inevitable, regardless of how we live our life, we're going to end up dying. Then we want to make sure that we die in the best way possible. Use the capital that we have of our life in the best way, and make sure that death is actually something meaningful. Not the death of a coward who always second guesses, changes his priorities based on comfort and based on these kinds of things. But rather you look like Imam Ali straight at death and say, you're not my concern, I've got to come to you anyway. But what do I have to do in the meantime? What do I do with the time that I'm given to make sure this is of the utmost value, profit the most from the time I'm given? And then when death is going to come, it's going to come. That's not in my hands. But what I can do with the life I have, that is solidly in my hands. I have full control over that. Oftentimes we do the exact opposite. We squander our life, and then we do everything we can to try to control death and delay it and push it back and fight with it. Right? The thing we have no control over, we try to have full control over, and where we have full control, we relinquish it totally. And then he continues, if sustenance is a portion decreed, then it is more suiting that a man not lust and hoard. And if money is collected to be left, whatever you collect is going to be left anyway, then why is man greedy with what he must leave? Right? One more phrase from Sahifa Sajjadi of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam. There is a salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. There is a dua in Sahifa Sajjadiyya that the Imam recites, and he prescribes it for whenever death is mentioned or you face death. This is a great dua. People always look for something to recite when they go and visit people in the hospital or when someone has just died. Right, so we have a dua in Sahifa Sajjadiyya about death. Whenever mention of death was made, the Imam would recite this particular dua. In the dua, this one stanza, he says, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. وَمَتِّعْنِي بِهُدًى صَالِحٍ لَا أَسْتَبْدِلُ بِهِ وَطَرِيقَةِ حَقٍ لَا أَزِيغُ عَنْهَا وَالنِّيَّةِ رُشْدٍ لَا أَشُكُّ فِيهَا. Right. Then he says, وَأَمِّرْنِي مَا كَانَ عُمُرِي بِذْلَةً فِي طَاعَتِكَ. He says, only give me life as long as my life is spent in your service. Right. So he doesn't ask for extended life, eternal life, give me a long life period. That's not his dua. Right, his dua is, give me life, extend my umr, as long as my umr is bidhlatan fi ta'atik, it's spent in your service. فَإِذَا كَانَ عُمُرِي مَرْتَعًا لِلشَّيْطَانِ فَاقْبِضْنِي إِلَيْكَ قَبْلَ أَن يَسْبِقَ مَقْتُكَ إِلَيْهِ أَوْ يَسْتَحْكِمَ غَضَبُكَ عَلَيْهِ. If it's on the horizon that from this point on, my life is now going to be a a fodder ground or like a field for shaitan to come in and play and eat and do these kinds of things. That my life basically becomes a playground for shaitan. If that's the case, then please take me before that happens. If I've been able to do anything good until now, and then from here on it's basically downhill, and now shaitan is going to have control over me and really lead me into a downward spiral, and my death will then be, I'll be, not only will I maintain, I'll now be at a lower state. And the Prophet said, well, I'm a loser if tomorrow is the same as today. What about if it's worse than today? He says, فَهُوَ مَلْعُونَ. The Prophet's, the hadith, it continues, مَنْ اسْتَوَى يَوْمَهُ فَهُوَ مَغْبُونَ وَمَنْ كَانَ ثَانِيَ يَوْمَيْهِ أَسْوَأَهُمَا فَهُوَ مَلْعُونَ. If your second day is worse than your today, then not only have you lost, now you're mal'oon, right? Damned by Allah for having squandered and wasted, not even maintained your capital. Now you've taken your capital, you put it in the garbage, you've wasted it, and this is your state now. So he says, if that's the case, then I don't want life. Take my life before I end up in that downward spiral, and I end up in a worse place than I am now. Right? That's the way to think about death, think about life and death. So we don't deny death, not intellectually, not practically. We realize it's a reality of life. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. We see the purpose of life itself. We see that death is inevitable. So instead of escaping it or trying to fend it off, we plow straight into it. We don't know when it's going to come, so why worry about when it's going to come? But we can focus on doing whatever we can with what we have, so that when we do die, which we will inevitably, it's in the best way possible. If we're going to die anyway, like Imam Hussein says, then why not die in God's way? Right, if you think about this, we have one idea that says that we don't know when we're going to die. On the other hand, we're constantly praying to die in God's way. And we praise those who are martyrs, whether they're martyrs in the battlefield or martyrs that they've lived their life in the service of God and then they die in that service. If I can't tell when I'm going to die, but I'm supposed to try to die in God's service, the only way to do that and ensure that is to make sure my life is in God's service. If my life is in God's service and every moment is I'm trying to do something for His sake, only then can I guarantee that whenever death comes, at any of these moments when it comes, at that moment I'll be in God's service because that's my habit now. I've arranged my life in that way. But if I think right now I'm going to take care of other things and then sometime at some later point then I'll do something for God, then there's absolutely no guarantee that you won't die before you ever get to God. Right? So if you idealize these people, the martyrs of Karbala, the way to live their life is to live in this way. With disregard for death, expectation that death is definite, and then you live your life and use it in the best way possible. Recite the salawat. So this is one of the problems with those two scenarios I gave you. That it reflects this kind of ideology that ignores the reality of death. So that's something that we can correct by refocusing on these ideas, not just intellectually, but also reflecting on our own mentality and how we think about our own life and death. We can try to rethink these things and fix our ideology so our perspective on death is something different. Another problem with those scenarios is that it prevents the family and friends who are around those people from enjoying those last few moments that they have with the person. This is the last opportunity they're going to have in the dunya at least. And if those last moments when the person is alive are spent in the chaos of medical service and all the different things that are happening, and you're pushed out and you're no longer allowed access, then that's the last memory you have of that person. What struck this home for me actually was a Christian kind of evangelical movie. There's a whole genre now of these movies, Hollywood quality movies, at least like, you know, technology-wise, Hollywood quality movies produced by the Christian evangelical community with their own messages, their own themes. So I watched one once to see what it was like, and one scene stuck in my mind. I don't even remember the whole storyline, but this one scene was so impressive because this person was a pastor of some sorts, struggling, trying to find meaning in his life as a pastor. And then he ends up, he's crossing the street with, you know, with the whole group, and a car runs a red light and strikes someone down. And the person's literally taking his last breaths. This pastor, he comes, examines the person. He recognizes this person is just about to die. He doesn't bother with, you know, someone call 911 and let's try to resuscitate him and all these things. He asks the person, do you believe in Jesus? Right? And he walks him through and helps him to come to terms with faith. And he gets him to say their equivalent of a shahada and say, yes, I accept Jesus Christ as my Savior. And then the guy dies. And that got me to think that that's the way a person should die. Right? Those should be our last actions with the person, to try to reconnect with them, reaffirm these beliefs. I'm going to share some ahadith with you in a little bit that talk about the etiquette and the kinds of practices we're supposed to engage in those last moments of a person's life. And we'll see it's very different, gives you a very different picture from those two scenarios I gave you at the beginning. It's something much, much more similar to this Christian pastor who focused on what's important, his priorities were straight, rather than wasting his time trying to save a person's life. It's not going to be saved. But he saved his soul, in his mind at least, he saved his soul and was able to get to him in a way that was very important. Right? These scenarios also prevents, this is a third problem with those scenarios, it prevents that person, the one who's dying, from being able to speak his last wishes to the living. Sometimes it's not possible, of course, sometimes the illness or the problems, whatever, are such that they're not able to communicate, maybe they can't even think straight in a way that they can communicate things. But sometimes it is the case, their body's dying, right? But their mind might still be alert. There's a hadith from Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He says, أَعْقَلُ مَا يَكُونُ الْمُؤْمِنُ عِنْدَ مَوْتِهِ, that the time when a believer is most keenly aware, most rational, and most thinking is at the time of death. Now again, that, it might not reflect itself in the way we think. They may not be able to speak or to speak coherently. That's not what the Imam is saying. They may not be able to speak any wisdom. But the reality of death is that the veils that have kept us away from reality, the distractions, are now slowly being peeled away. As our attachment to the dunya and even to our physical body is loosening, those barriers and those veils that are there that prevent us from seeing reality, they start to peel away and we start to see clearer and clearer. Right? And so the person at this point, when they're just on the verge of death, they're seeing as clearly as possible, the clearest they've ever seen in their entire life is this moment now. So if they are in the position where they can speak, this is the best time to hear from them. And we see the practice of the imams and the prophet whenever they were in this situation, if they were in a position where they were, you know, able to speak till the end, that's when they would share wisdom with their family members. We have so many wasiya, exhortations that they would give to their loved ones. And that's really, you can imagine, that's going to be the most important thing they have to say. Right? If I'm going to meet you for the last time, I'm going to say my last farewells to you, and I'm not sure if I'm ever going to see you again, that's when I'm going to say what's really on my mind, what's most important for you. Right? So by designing death in such a way as those scenarios I gave you, it denies that person the ability to be able to impart that wisdom, to give those last exhortations, those last pieces of wisdom they want to their family members. There's one another tradition from Nahj al-Balagha where Imam Ali al-Islam describes the process of death in a very intuitive and insightful way. So it's the death of an unbeliever, a death of a person who hasn't really used his life properly, but the process is the same for all of us. Let me read the translation of this tradition. He says, how unexpectedly do the pangs of death of which they knew not befall them. How suddenly does the separation from this world, from which they believe themselves immune, overtake them? How quickly do they proceed toward the hereafter as they had always been promised? Indescribable is what befalls them. At once the pangs of death and the remorse of lost opportunity convene upon them. As a consequence, their extremities go flaccid and their color goes pale. Then death penetrates a little more. Such a person is barred from the faculty of speech. He lies before his family, seeing with his eyes, hearing with his ears, with a mind still sound, with which he wonders, what did I do with my life? How did I waste my years? Right? So faculties are dying. He's not able to speak or see anymore, but he can still think very clear. In fact, even more clearly than he ever thought before. Right now he realizes that all that time that I spent, all the energy I spent, that was really a waste. Right? This is the moment I should have been living for. In fact, I lived for every moment before this, and now when I need my own actions, I can't even do anything for myself. Now I'm helpless, and now is when I really need myself to be able to help myself in some way. What did I do with my life? How did I waste my years? He recalls wealth he amassed, in whose acquisition he was careless, taking it from both lawful and doubtful sources. The ill consequences of amassing it now follow him as he is about to bid the wealth itself farewell. He bids the wealth farewell, but what goes with him to his grave is the burden of all the sins that he acquired while pursuing that wealth. It's full loss and no benefit. The benefit's now gone, only the loss remains. The wealth will remain for those who come after him who will enjoy it. The savor shall be for another while the burden falls on his back. Your kids will enjoy it, but you're the one who will have to pay the price for having sought it in a haram way. This man pawned his soul for his wealth. Now he bites his hand in regret for the matters he must face at the time of his death. He feels indifferent to the things he longed for throughout his life. And he wishes the one who envied him and was jealous of him had procured it all instead of him. Right? Others were jealous, they wished they could have what I had, and I felt so proud that you can't. You can't touch me. I have stuff that you can't have. And now, as I'm dying, I wish that I hadn't been so arrogant, and I wish that they had won, and they had been able to get my position and my wealth and whatever benefit I had. And I had been spared that. If I had been spared that, at least I wouldn't have to bear the burden now that I'm bearing. Death continues to increase its hold on his body until it mingles with his hearing. So he is left before his family, neither able to speak with his tongue, nor hear with his ears. He shifts his eyes, looking at their faces. He sees the movements of their lips, but he does not hear the intent of their speech. Then death permeates him more. His sight is taken as his hearing had been taken. His spirit leaves his body and he becomes but a corpse before his family. Now they have fled from his side in terror and distanced themselves from him. He cannot help him who mourns for him, nor can he answer him who calls for him. He still hears. He's still totally conscious, even though he's dead. He still hears his family members crying for him and calling out and saying, "Where have you gone and why have you left us?" But he can't do anything now. He can't even answer them anymore. Then they carry him to a ditch in the ground and relinquish him therein to his deeds, and they cease to visit him. So this is Imam Ali alayhi salam's description of death. So in those last moments, the person has an increased ability to perceive. We should benefit from that. And if we let death happen in the way that it usually happens, we deny that person that benefit, we deny ourselves that benefit. It prevents closure. There's no sense of closure in that kind of a death. Oftentimes you see, once the person's dead and all the emergency service people leave, the doctors leave and say, and they pronounce the person dead, it's at that point that the family gets to come in and say their goodbyes or whatever they want to do, or pray and these sorts of things. Once the person's already gone. When they were there, they could have been part of the dying process itself, but because they made the wrong choices and the system itself was in a way skewed in a way and had the wrong priorities, the system forced them into a kind of death that was both a loss for the person who died and a loss for the people who were still to survive. Maybe the most important problem with this kind of a death is that it doesn't allow the dying person to maximize their benefit from the last few moments that they have. The only chance we have to actually control our fate into the hereafter is the time that we have before death. We don't realize how precious the moments are. We end up, especially in youth and in health, we end up not using our time very carefully. For those of you who are older, if you're reflective, if you reflect on yourself and you have more of a sense of urgency and you feel like, now I'm closer to death, I've lived a life and I don't feel like I've done much, whatever time I have left, let me make it count now. So as we get older, typically, if we're reflective, then we become a little bit more efficient in our usage of our time for things that are most important and most good in the hereafter. Those last moments, you can imagine, it's going to be so critical and so important for the person who's dying that these are the last seconds that I have now before my book of deeds is sealed. These are critical moments where I can say my last istighfar and seek forgiveness for a sin. I can reaffirm my faith before I have no control anymore. As long as we're here, we can decide what to do. We can make a choice. We can decide to believe. As soon as death comes, then all choices are off. We have no more choice in anything. From then on, you can't strengthen your faith. You can't do anything for yourself. Even though those veils are opened, at this point, the certainty that you have does you no good. It's only the certainty that we can acquire during this life that avails us in the hereafter. Once you're dead, once the curtains are pulled forth, there's no virtue in having certainty. Everyone has certainty. The evilest of people who rejected God flatly, who thought himself to be God in place of Allah, even that person sees with certainty at that point that everything was a lie and everything was false, and now here's reality. So faith at that point has no value. It's only the faith that we can acquire before that last breath. So these are the last moments the person has to spend, and then we give them this kind of a send-off where there's chaos and resuscitation and procedures and invasions into his body and intubation and all these different things, and those are his last moments instead of something meaningful, peaceful, reflective, instead of exhortation and dua and these kinds of things. So let me share with you some of the ahadith that we have from the Ahlul Bayt, where they talk about the etiquette that we should practice during ihtidar. That's a good term to know. Ihtidar comes from the same word as hudur, presence. So ihtidar is, they have different ideas for why it's called ihtidar, but it's basically when you're on your deathbed. Death is present, or you are present before death, or the angel is present. There are different reasons why we might call it ihtidar. But the person who's on the deathbed is called a muhtadar. Right, so the adab and even the laws, there are certain laws that come into play where we have to do certain things for the muhtadar. Of course, they can't do anything for themselves at that point. Usually they can't move physically and these kinds of things. But the people around them, Muslims around them, have a duty to treat them in a certain way and do certain things for them. So let me read through some of these ahadith and it'll give us a sense for the kinds of duties that we should be engaged in, the kinds of priorities we should have in the last moments as the person's dying. In the first tradition, Imam Ali alayhi salam quotes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah salli ala Muhammad wa alihi. He says, "Dakhala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi ala rajulin min wuldi Abd al-Muttalib wa huwa fi as-souq." So Imam Ali narrates that the Prophet came to one of his cousins from the Banu Abd al-Muttalib when they're in the process of dying. Wa qad wujjiha bighayri al-qibla. So one of the duties that we have, if someone's dying, so you go to the hospital or whatever, and you see you have someone who is on their deathbed, one of the duties that we have is to make sure they're facing the Qibla, that they die facing the Qibla. And the way you face the Qibla at this point is by putting your feet towards the Qibla. Right? So the Qibla is this way, right? In this room? Yeah, so basically like the way many of you are facing, if you were just to lie down with your head going towards that wall, on your back, supine, and your feet facing towards the Qibla, that would be the position of ihtidar. So basically, if the person were to sit up, they would be facing the Qibla. The bottom of their feet are facing towards the Qibla. That's the proper position. Right? Which is never going to be observed in a hospital. It's going to be based on convenience. But you have the right and you have the freedom. If you know the rule, it's a wajib actually. It's wajib for the people alive to make the person face. If they can't, if he can move himself, he needs to move. And if he can't, then people need to help him to move in that position. That's something important to put in our advanced directives and in, you know, in wasiyas and stuff, so they're ready and handy. You can hand them to those same professionals and let them know, these are the things I need to do in these last moments. فَقَالَ, the Prophet says, وَجِّهُهُ إِلَى الْقِبْلَى. Right? When the Prophet comes into the room, the cousin of his is facing the wrong direction. So he immediately comes in and says, turn him around. His first thing that he does is not, is he okay, or let me resuscitate him, or let's try to fend off death. Let's prepare him for death. Face him in the right direction. Right? فَإِنَّكُمْ إِذَا فَعَلْتُمْ ذَلِكَ أَقْبَلَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ مَلَائِكَ وَأَقْبَلَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ عَلَيْهِ. And this is a way to increase the spirituality of this person at this point. The angels, their connection can be better with that person if he's facing the Qibla. In the same way, our attention, not only our attention, but just the whole spiritual situation for us when we face the Qibla is stronger than if we face in other directions. Not only for prayer, but so much of our life is supposed to be oriented around the Qibla. Right? It's wajib in prayer, but then even when you're using the bathroom, you have to keep in mind where the Qibla is so you're not facing the direction. It's mustahab when you're studying to face the Qibla, when you're eating to face the Qibla. When you're, even in lectures, it's mustahab actually for the speaker to face away from the Qibla so the whole audience is all facing towards the Qibla. Even in a court of law, it's mustahab for the judge to face away so that all the people who are present in the court, they face towards the Qibla. What else? There are, even when you're asleep. When you sleep, it's also mustahab to face the Qibla. This time, not the same way as I described for the muhtadar, but this time it's like you're in your grave. Right, so the way you lie in the grave with yourself on the right side, so in this room, your head would be going that way, right? Your feet this way, and you'd be on your right side, kind of upright like this, facing towards the Qibla. That's the way we'll lie in our grave. Sleep is a minor death. Allahu yatawaffa al-anfusa hina mawtiha wallati lam tamut fi manamiha. Allah takes our souls at the time of death, if death is ordained, and if it's not ordained, at the time of sleep, He takes our souls. It's a temporary death until morning, and then He gives us our souls back. And the dua when you wake up is Alhamdulillah alladhi radda alayya ruhi ba'da id amatani. Praises to Allah who has given me my soul back after having killed me. He took me at night. I've been dead all night. Now I've come back. He's giving my soul back for one more day. Yeah. Then he says, wa aqbal Allahu alayhi bi wajhi. فَلَمْ يَزَلْ كَذَلِكَ حَتَّى يُقْبَدْ. So this person, once the Prophet turned him like that, then they did all the other things until the person finally died. Another hadith from Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. قَالَ إِذَا حَضَرْتَ الْمَيِّتَ قَبْلَ أَن يَمُوتَ فَلَقِّنْهُ شَهَادَةَ أَنْ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. He says, if you come into the presence of a person who's dying before they actually die, then the thing to think about is to do talqeen. Talqeen is another good word to know. For these death rituals, they have a couple of vocabulary words you should know. Muhtadar is one, the person on the deathbed. Talqeen is a kind of prompting of someone. Like your kids, when you have a play or a performance at school, you might forget your lines. Your teacher's over there with the script, and they'll prompt you kind of quietly, so no one else hears that you can hear your next line. That's called talqeen, right? So this at this instance as well, we're advised to prompt the person who's in the process of dying to say the shahadatain. Right? Tell them, go up to them, tell them, you know, shake them, wake them up, make sure they're alert, and say, you know, say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Walk them through it. Say it word by word. If they can't do it, you know, get them to do it. Get them to acknowledge, to move their lips, to point their finger, to do something to acknowledge the shahadatain at this point. Another hadith also from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam.
قال ما من أحد يحضره الموت إلا وكل به إبليس من شياطينه من يأمره بالكفر ويشككه في دينه حتى تخرج نفسه.
He says that when death comes to a person, that's when this is not only your last chance to fix your life, it's also Iblis's last chance to make sure that you were misguided. So just as we should have a heightened sense of urgency at that point to try to get one last shahadatain and one last dua in, realize that shaitan's also there with one last chance to try to make you doubt in your beliefs, to bring some shak in you, right? To make you reject something that's essential, that's going to serve you well in the hereafter.
فَمَنْ كَانَ مُؤْمِنًا لَمْ يَقْدِرْ عَلَيْهِ.
One of the defenses that we have against him is our iman. So the hadith says, if you're a believer, then shaitan has no power over you at that time. Right? Mu'min, right? Not simply that we call ourselves Muslim or Shi'i or those kinds of things. Not by name at this point. This is reality. Right? So if we actually have faith, if we're actually believers, then that belief, that strength of faith, that certainty that we have in the truth, that will fortify us against his ruses and his machinations.
فَإِذَا حَضَرْتُمْ مَوْتَاكُمْ فَلَقِّنُوهُمْ شَهَادَةَ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ حَتَّى يَمُوتُوا.
So he says, whenever you come in the presence of one of your people who's about to die, then help them. Or you don't know what their state is. They probably don't even know what their state is. They don't know how strong or weak their faith is. Right? So we can't rely on the strength of their previous faith. At this point, they need you to remind them, to prompt them, to get them to reaffirm the most important thing, which is the shahadatain. So that should be our first thought when we go and visit someone in the hospital who's about to die, when somebody drops dead has a heart attack and is writhing. Instead of thinking about so many other things, think about these things. The person, they're going to die either at this point or maybe they'll survive. Maybe let other people worry about health services, those kinds of things. But in the meantime, what you can do is prepare the person for these last moments in case they are his last moments. And so you can talk to him and get him to recite the shahadatain.
Imam al-Sadiq also says, أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ دَخَلَ عَلَى رَجُلٍ مِّن بَنِي هَاشِمْ وَهُوَ يَقْضِي.
So the Prophet again came to one of the Banu Hashim while the person was in the process of dying.
فَقَالَ لَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ العلي العظيم لا إله إلا الله الحليم الكريم سبحان الله رب السماوات السبع ورب الأراضين السبع وما بينهن وما تحتهن ورب العرش العظيم والحمد لله رب العالمين.
Is that dua familiar? Yeah, in a hadith they call this كلمات الفرج or dua الفرج. We have other duas that we also call dua الفرج, but this they refer to as كلمات الفرج. The sentences are affirmations of those most important beliefs in Tawheed. Acknowledging Allah as the one, the Lord of everything, all of the cosmos and these kinds of things. So it's that kind of a really significant thing. It's one of the mustahab du'as. You can say any du'a in Qunut, but this particular du'a is mentioned in Mafatih or in the Risala as well. When they recommend a particular du'a for Qunut, this is the one they recommend. Yeah, so if you look in your Tawdih Masail or Islamic laws or whatever, you'll find this dua is probably there. It's good to memorize it, practice it. The more we can practice these things and they become second nature, the more naturally they come out of us at those critical moments. Right? If it's just in some book and I read it one time, let me go find it. Right? At critical times when it's high stress, you're never going to think about all those things. But things that are second nature, right, they will come out. I've seen people who are on the verge of fainting. They're just about unconscious, and I would say salawat, and the person would jump up and say, "Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad." Like that would come out even though they're on the verge of unconsciousness because they're so used to saying it. Right.
All right. One more hadith from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
So this is a story of, again, of the Prophet near someone who was on the verge of death.
حَضَرَ رَجُلًا
الموت فقيل يا رسول الله إن فلانا قد حضره الموت فنهض رسول الله. So a person was on the verge of death. His family and friends, they go to the Prophet and say he's about to die. The Prophet quickly comes to his bedside. ومعه ناس من أصحابه. Many of his companions were with him. وهو مغمى عليه. The person, by the time the Prophet gets there, he's already unconscious.
فقال يا ملك الموت كف عن الرجل حتى أسائله فأفاق الرجل.
So the Prophet, in his position, able to talk to the angels, he calls on the angel of death and says, relinquish this person for a few moments. Just give me a few moments with him. Let him come back to consciousness so I can speak to him. I want to ask him some questions.
فأفاق الرجل. The person comes to. فقال النبي ما رأيت؟ قال رأيت بياضا كثيرا وسوادا كثيرا.
So the Prophet asks him, when you're unconscious just now, what did you see? And so he says that I saw lots of white and I also saw lots of black.
قال فأيما كان أقرب إليك؟ أقرب إليك. فقال السواد.
The Prophet asks him, which of the two, the white or the black, which was closer to you? He says, the black was closer to me.
فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وآله قل اللهم اغفر لي الكثير من معاصيك.
He says, repeat the following dua. Oh Allah, forgive me my many sins.
واقبل مني اليسير من طاعتك.
And accept my measly and my meager acts of devotion to you. So I have many sins, forgive those. I have few acts of obedience, accept those.
ثم أغمي عليه.
And the person recites the dua, and then he goes unconscious.
فقال يا ملك الموت خفف عنه حتى أسائله.
Again, the Prophet asks the angel of death, let him come back to life. I need to ask him again. So he comes back to life.
فقال ما رأيت.
He asks him again, what did you see? قال رأيت بياضا كثيرا وسوادا كثيرا. Again, he says, I saw lots of black and lots of white. The Prophet says, أيهما أقرب. Which one is closer to you? He says, now the white is closer to me than the black.
فقال رسول الله غفر الله لصاحبكم.
So he turns to his companions and says, Allah has forgiven this friend of yours.
فقال أبو عبد الله إذا حضرتم ميتا فقولوا له هذا الكلام ليقوله.
So then Imam al-Sadiq derives a lesson from the Prophet's story and he says, you, whenever you go to someone who's dying, then do what the Prophet did. Of course, we can't call on the angel of death, but we can teach him the dua. I do talqeen of that dua, and the dua will help the person, whatever their state was. Say, these are the important things. Get them to affirm their faith in the shahadatain, and get them to seek forgiveness for their many sins and acceptance of their few good deeds.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
All right. I was hoping to share a little bit more, but I think the time is also running out. So we'll speak about the rest of it tomorrow. Let me just recap quickly. So what we've talked about is we have priorities. One of the priorities that we currently express is the priority of life at all costs. That should be changed. Right? Life is overrated, and death, we're not nearly prepared enough for that. Let's keep life in perspective, maximize it while we have it, yes, but then realize that death is inevitable and prepare for that. And then when death comes, that's, of course, at that point it's too late to really fix these kinds of things. That's why it's so important to examine the priorities now for ourselves so that we can prepare for our own death and that we can prepare for the death of those around us. Maybe we have to make systemic changes. There are faith communities who have influenced the medical system in such a way that they bend over backwards to accommodate them, right? Jehovah's Witnesses and some of the other groups, they have certain requirements that their religions dictate, and it's known, right? And so the medical system also makes sure to accommodate those kinds of needs that they have. If we, first of all, connect with our deen ourselves and know what our deen requires of us, prioritize those things that Allah has prioritized for us, then we can affect policy. Change the way things happen in the system, at least for ourselves, if not in the system as a whole. At least for Muslims, you carry your card, you have some system in place that they know that, okay, this is a Muslim, we need to do, here's the protocol now. Right? At very least, if you can't affect the system, you can affect yourself and your own will, your own advanced directive. make sure that, you know, it's written there. Make sure your family members know how they should proceed. If not even when death comes. And we always use if when you talk about death. It's almost a habit, as though there's a chance it might not come. It should be when death comes, right? That's the way we should plan. Let's talk about when I die. Here's what I want you to do. This is what I want you to think about. This is the way it should go. That's not morbid. That's reality. That's practical. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. I'm going to read briefly from part of the story of the aftermath of Karbala. This is in the court of Yazid, when the captives have been brought there. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam asks Yazid for permission to speak. Yazid conceded on condition that he not speak nonsense. Imam al-Sajjad retorted, "I am a position in which it is not fitting for the likes of me to speak nonsense." Yazid ordered his orator to ascend the pulpit and praise Muawiyah and curse Hussein. He cursed Ali and Hussein profusely until Imam Zain al-Abidin chided him, the speaker, and said, "You have bought the approval of creatures at the expense of angering the Creator. Ready yourself for your place in the fire." And then he recites a couplet. He says, "Do you curse him from atop a pulpit which stands only by the grace of his sword?" Right? The pulpit is there because of Ali's sword, and here you are on top of this pulpit that Ali himself established and he made sure stayed there, and you're on top of that pulpit cursing the one who created the pulpit and protected it. Imam Zain al-Abidin said to Yazid, "Do you now give me leave to ascend these pieces of wood?" He doesn't even honor the mimbar, calling it a mimbar. He says, "These pieces of wood, can I go climb on top of these pieces of wood and talk to the people?" Because they've degraded the mimbar into this place where you can do Latin of the Prophet's family. This is no longer a mimbar. This is just a bunch of wood that's assembled there that can climb to the top of this pile of wood. "And speak words which will please God and bring these people reward." Yazid refused, but the people insisted. Imam Zain al-Abidin delivers the following sermon. He says, "Praises for God for whom there is no beginning, the eternal for whom there is no end, the first for whom there is no first, and the last for whom there is no last. The one who will remain after creation's end. He ordained the night and the day, and in their midst he apportioned provisions. Blessed is God, the omniscient sovereign. O people," he says, "we have been given six things and we have been honored with seven. We have been given knowledge, forbearance, generosity, eloquence, courage, and people's love. And we have been honored with the Prophet, the Confirmer Ali, Ja'far al-Tayyar, the Lion of God and his Messenger Hamza, and the two grandsons, Al-Hasan and Al-Hussein, and the Mahdi and Savior of this nation. O people, whoever knows me, knows me. If anyone does not know me, I shall inform him of my lineage. O people, I am the son of Mecca and Mina. I am the son of Zamzam and Safa. I am the son of him who carried the black stone by the corners of his cloak. I am the son of the best one to have ever donned the ihram or performed the sa'i or tawaf or the hajj. I am the son of him who was carried by the Buraq, whom Gabriel conveyed to the lote tree of high, who was from his Lord a bow length away or less. I am the son of him who prayed with the angels in the skies. I am the son of him upon whom the Almighty revealed his revelation. I am the son of him who fought for the messenger at Badr and Hunayn, who never rejected God even for an instant. I am the son of the righteous believer, the heir of the prophets, the leader of the Muslims, the guiding light of the warriors, the one who fought the defaulters, the transgressors, and the iniquitous, the one who scattered the confederation. He is the father of the two grandsons, Al-Hasan and Al-Hussein, Ali ibn Abi Talib. I am the son of Fatima to Zahra, the mistress of all women. I am the son of Khadija the Great. I am the son of him who lies drenched in his blood. I am the son of him who was slaughtered at Karbala. I am the son of him for whom even the jinn now weep, and for whom the birds in the sky lament. When the Imam reached this point, the crowd wailed in grief. Yazid feared that the crowd would turn into a mob, so he ordered his Mu'adhin to make the call for prayer. The Mu'adhin called out, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Imam Zain al-Abidin in affirmation said, God is greater, more glorious, higher, and more noble than all that I fear. The Mu'adhin called out, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Imam Zain al-Abidin said, yes, I too declare with every other Muslim that there is no deity but him and no Lord save him. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Imam Zain al-Abidin interrupted the Mu'adhin saying, I ask you by the right of Muhammad to be silent a moment while I speak to this man, Yazid. And he turned to Yazid and asked, this dear and noble messenger, is he your forefather or mine? If you claim he is your forefather, all who are present and all people alive will know you are a liar. And if you admit that he is mine, then why did you kill my father through injustice and transgression and loot his belongings and imprison his women? Damn you on the day of judgment when my forefather will be your opponent. As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdillah wa ala al-arwah allati halat bi fina'ik. عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. Allah, we ask you to shower your mercy and blessings on Muhammad and the family of Muhammad. Allah, we ask you to accept the meager deeds that we do to try to please you and to forgive us for the major and many sins that we commit. We ask you to help us to benefit and increase our knowledge through these discussions. Help us, inshallah, to reorganize our priorities in a way that's pleasing to you. Help us to come to terms with death and to think about death in the healthiest of ways, and to use our reflections on death as a way to reorder our life and to live our life in a way that's pleasing to you. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.